Hello friends, welcome back to TMYS Academy. Today I am with Meenu Bagla. Meenu is a corporate leader and she has a very, very compelling story to say. And today's session is very, very special as together I and Meenu, we will construct that particular diagram of life, which happens when you want success, but when you have a lot of setbacks, which you must dive out of. And in the process, the kind of journey that we all take or we must take, or it happens to us in some way or the other eventually. So welcome to the show, Meenu.
Thank you so much, Coral, for thinking of me as a story, first of all. I just thought I was living my life.
We all have our stories and all of those stories are very important. And you have carved a very important story of yours. So to begin with, let me invite you to tell your story to us and from there we take on.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Coral. Well, my is not... definitely not a fairy tale. I was born and brought up in a conservative, middle-class Marwari family, a joint family for that matter. You know, while we were growing up, we were told that by the time you're 21, you should get married, okay, and have children, and just go on being a good wife and a mother and blah, 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 blah. But I must tell you, from the very beginning, I was a rebel. I would rebel against any rule that was imposed upon me. And trust me, you can ask my mom, she'll swear by it, you know, that this was a rebellion child. So I think my first rebellion started when I decided to go to B school and move out of my hometown. And, you know, after getting out of the B school, fell in love with a great guy. Unfortunately, that didn't turn out to be a great story. While at the age of 28, when other girls were planning on huge weddings and great honeymoons and a great life ahead, I actually had a two-month-old baby in my arms. And I was actually moving out of my million-dollar mansion from the US to India without any job in hand or any employment opportunity. And at home, my parents were not keeping well. So I think this was classic crisis management period in my life. And I think at that point in time, there were so many moments where I sat back and said, I think this is it. I just don't think I will be able to cope up with it. But you know what? You know, when people say that motherhood gives you strength and you really don't believe in it, you feel that, you know, it's just one of those stories that your moms have been telling you. I think motherhood gave me huge, huge amount of strength. And I decided, you know, Meenu Bagla, you got to live the life of a rebel. So move on and take charge of your life. And I, in fact, started to do a night job when I came back to India because I wanted to, you know, spend the daytime with my son. And that's how the life went for 2 years. But thankfully, I had great boss. I had a great job. And I really gave my heart to it. So I got promotions and I got increments and I got raises very quickly. And soon I moved on into mainstream jobs in IT industry. And today I'm here with you, Coral, mother of a 16-year-old, happy, I would say fulfilled, right? And loved and respected.
You know, that is indeed a very, very, very touching and very difficult story as I can... as I hear it, obviously you must have, you are probably the custodian of that entire period of time when you have experienced it all yourself. And when I hear it, I literally, you must have seen that I was at a lot of loss of words. It was not something that, it was something that came naturally, that I indeed had lost words. So, you know, that entire period of time when you came out and you replanned your life, because when you must have got married and settled, there are certain things that you expect from your life. And when you come out, you don't know what to expect. Mm-hmm. Right? And after that, you constructed your life, you build it up, and you build it up so well that today you are a corporate leader in a marketing function and you are going places. Where did it all start from? Is something that you have probably already answered, that you started with a night job. Now, I want to ask you a few things, a few firsts in your life. which will probably help us build that diagram, a graphical chart of how probably life is, which is not easy. But then if we have to find a trend and help people understand that the lowest setbacks can be leveraged in a different way and something else can be built out of it. A lot of things are required, one of them being patience and the other thing being hard work. Another, yet another thing being trying to understand where it all goes and be a little researchive about it in your brain. So my first question, Minu, your first interview, how was that and how did it go?
Wow, I still remember. I gave my first interview actually over a call while I was still planning to move back to India. And I had put my baby to sleep. And I think it was 11:30 a.m. Central Time Zone in the U.S. And I was to get on a call with, who became my, next boss. And I was just thinking, why would he take me back into a great, role, although it might be a night job? And will I be able to do it? I had all kind of doubts in my mind, okay? I was insecure a bit. I was afraid a bit. I was scared a bit because, I'd be going back with a baby in my hand, right? But you know what? There was a part of me which said, Minu, if you have done this much, you can do this as well. And you got to be determined about it. So my first job interview was all about confidence in my own skill, in my own courage, in my own fight, and in myself. I think that was my first meeting and interview was all about. But I must say, Coral, I don't know whether it's part of our covered agenda, but my first struggle or my first experience of getting over a huge struggle and demonstration of my own determination happened way early in my life. So I'm sure, all of us who wanted to become MBAs during our young years, we had to give CAT, right? CAT exam. And I still remember, I used to live in Indore. We were, a small family there. And it was just 11 days to go for the CAT exam. And I had my right wrist fractured. Okay. And I had applied, of course, when we give CAT, we applied to, at least 5-6 major institutions to ensure that you would get into one of them. So the choice in front of me was that either you skip the exam, you take a break for an entire year, okay, give it next year, or you just give it up, okay? And the other option was somehow manage to give the exam, okay? And believe it or not, Coral, in 10 days, I practiced writing with my left hand. And I realized that I was very, very good at calculations, okay? So I literally didn't have to write calculation for CAT exam. I had to just practice filling up those circles for CAT exam. And I practiced and I practiced and I practiced with my left hand. And I gave my entire CAT exam with my left hand. And I still got through maybe one of the top 10 institutions. So I think that's the first story of determination.
My next question, Minu, you have just spoken about your first interview. I wanted to ask you about your first job, which you said was a night shift. Tell me about that part of your story, because night shift with a child, you say that you wanted to spend time with your child during the day. When did you sleep?
Oh, yeah.
What was about your own rest, your own mental stability? And for every child needs a happy mother, right? And if you are trying to spend time with your child, obviously, there was some level of happiness that you found within your child because of which you did it. But then you are a human being. Your body has its own capacities. How did you manage that, your first job?
Well, I would say, I think the first thing that helped me was I had my parents with me, okay? They were a huge support. And not just support in terms of physical support. They were a huge emotional support. And they said, Minu, we know you are a determined girl. We know you will go through it, okay? But honestly, Coral, every morning was a struggle because I would go to work at 4:30 in the afternoon and I would come back by 2:30, okay? And I wanted to ensure that I'm there when my son wakes up. So I would sleep between 3 and 6. And I would ensure that I would, you know, make little breakfast or whatever is required and be with him. And I would sleep in sync with his naps. So that's all I used to do in terms of syncing up my sleep. So it was maybe what, 4.5 hours to, yeah, maximum 4.5 hours of sleep for almost 2 years. But I'll tell you, I don't regret it at all, because each moment that I spent with my son would give me so much energy to go through the day. That was just fantastic. And thankfully, even the bosses at work were very supportive. You know, there were days when, you know, I would have to, let's say, you know, come in late for an hour or two, and they were absolutely fine with it. So I think I worked for leaders who were great human beings, you know, who were great coaches. So that's been my journey for my, you know, in my first job.
Okay, my third, exactly from where you stopped right now, your first boss. I ask you this primarily because your first boss can actually make or break your life, your career, your interest in your job, your belief in yourself, your confidence, everything practically. So your first boss, was that your first job? That was not your first job, just post.
That was not my first job.
You did work before that.
Yes, right? Yes. So when I got out of my B school, you know, this was a startup, right? Which was planning to hire business development managers. And you know, the pre-placement talks and everything was going on. And I was very excited and I got into the entire organization. The internship was supposed to happen in Chennai. I had just passed order from Nirma University. So I was in Ahmedabad. We went to Chennai. And my first boss is still my mentor. I think that says it all. Okay. And you are absolutely right, Coral, that your first boss can actually make or break your career. Okay. Thankfully, he was a great human being, a great coach, a great father, okay, and very, very secure and giving human being. I think that says it all. And he gave me the opportunity to get my first international assignments within 6 months of internship. And during those days, I'm talking about the year of 2000, right? Mm-hmm. You know, getting into an international assignment within 6 months was a big deal.
Absolutely.
So I think he was the guy who gave me the first, or he was a gentleman who gave me my first international break. And I still owe my career to him.
Totally understandable with the kind of words that you have used. I understand that he must have had immense impact in your life.
Yes.
My next, Meenu, a very crucial thing that we often talk about, but seldom take it sportingly when it comes, your first failure.
Right. You know, interestingly, I think I have had too many failures, both in personal and professional life, and that kind of makes me fearless. I think I would not say my first failure, Kurul, but my first big failure, right, if I recall,
yes,
was when I was working for a very large IT firm. Again, a great organization, a great brand. I think anybody who knows my career would know which company I'm talking about. And we were supposed to go live for one of the financial services technology show in London, okay, and demonstrate our first IP, okay, in the area of, you know, banking innovation and all that. And we were all set, you know, we are talking about almost 7,000 people in the hall itself. And there were maybe, I don't know, thousands others were watching it online or stuff like that. And as soon as we pressed click, the software hung up.
Oh.
And of course, you know, the first reaction is, you know, the first thing that comes to your mind, oh my God, this is now done. Okay. There's nothing else that can happen. Right. It's so much of embarrassment. It's being tweeted about, it's being posted, it's being photographed and blah, blah, blah. But guess what? We went backstage. Okay. So we, of course, paused the demonstration. We went backstage. We actually called the CEO of our company. Okay. And we called the producer of the show and we said, we want another chance. Okay. Mm-hmm. And 30 minutes later, we went back on the stage, demonstrated the entire software, and we said, this is how it's done. So never, ever take your failures as, you know, to bog you down. Never, ever. And I think each failure makes you, you know, much more fearless. But was it possible only because I was feeling like it? No. I think the team, the leaders, it matters a lot, right? But yes, I think that was the first big failure. And the only way to deal with it was to stay positive and turn it into an opportunity. And, you know, the interesting part is how it became an opportunity, Coral, was the slot that we paid for, okay, to do the demo was actually not a prime slot. But because we couldn't do the demo at that time and they had to continue the show, the rest of the shots actually got, you know, rescheduled. And we had got the prime shot. So, you know, I think at the end, it all went well.
It somehow conspires to make sure that your hard work does have
absolutely. If you have the right will, I think the universe will conspire to, you know, help you become successful. Absolutely.
Next, your first achievement.
Wow.
I ask this because your first achievement is your self-boost, right? You just feel that, yes, I have it in me. You knew it throughout, but then there is a proof before the world. So mm-hmm. that is the reason I really want to know that first achievement, which must have done that to you.
Absolutely. I must say I'm a late bloomer. Because my first achievement, if I recall, was pretty late in my career. So I would answer it in two phases, Coral. You know, my first achievement where I felt really good about myself as a daughter, as a human being, was while I was preparing for CAT, I was also doing coaching on verbal reasoning for my peers. I was really, really good at verbal reasoning. So the coaching center where I was doing the coaching, I was also teaching verbal reasoning. And I think during those times, I used to get 500 rupees a month.
Okay.
To teach verbal reasoning for CAT aspirants. Okay. Please don't roll this out to everyone because 500 rupees a month today, even a nursery teacher probably charges more. Okay. So, but, and I remember I did it for almost a year. And I had saved that money and I bought a small mixie for my mom.
Okay.
And I remember it was a surprise for her. Okay. She wasn't expecting it. And she, of course, you know, did not think that I had saved all that money. And I still remember her smile when she was unwrapping it. I think that is my first memory of achievement. Okay. As a daughter, and I think nothing can replace that, right? However, you know, as you go on, as you grow, my first big achievement was we were presenting to the chairman of a very, very large organization, okay? And, you know, the MD asked a question about, so if all this business model is in place, okay, and we are an online company, what do you think should be done? And pretty much, you know, like everybody else, everybody was trying to figure out the complication and the complexities and try to give answers about, you know, how the strategy won't work, you know, the execution won't work, you know, budgets would be an issue and so on and so forth. And I remember I was sitting there, I was too young. Okay, I was probably the youngest in the room. And I was like, okay, should I open my mouth and really ask a question or make a comment? Because this could be a career terminating move. But then I did. And I asked the question to the chairman, after all of this, what happens to logistics? Okay. And he was like, you get it. It is all about logistics. Okay. And I must tell you, Coral, that got me into a different role altogether. And I still remember, and I still tell that at a case study to my team, that sometimes the simplest answers are the best answers.
Absolutely.
Right? Don't overthink.
The last one, Minu, your first raise, which you have probably just said. Here, I am not talking about just raise in terms of a hike or in terms of a designation, but a first raise where you felt in your professional life that you have done something which has taken you as a professional and as a human being on a different level.
Absolutely. I think I remember that moment very, very clearly. I had just set up a large innovation center for financial services, again, for a very large IT company that I worked for. And I was, you know, largely helping them doing their go-to-market, etc. And there was an opportunity to be the global marketing head for that business unit. And that business unit was almost $2 billion, you know, in those days, okay? And one of my coaches and mentors said, why don't you go and, you know, pitch for that role? And I'm like, oh, no way. You know, I think I'm just too young and too junior. And, you know, I was just trying to give myself an explanation. I'm not good for it, okay? And, but, you know, knowing me as a rebel, I said, doesn't matter. Let's go ahead and try it. Worst come worst, what will happen? I'll not get it, okay? And I did pitch for it. And I got it. Out of term, I was probably the youngest, okay, and heading the largest business unit and being the global marketing head at that age was just amazing. I think that put my, that catapulted my career into a different orbit altogether, Kural. And even for that, I must tell you that, you know, it might sound like it was my pitch and my effort, but if I look back, it was my mentor, my coach, right? The leaders who supported me, the leaders who saw the talent in me. And I think it's very, very important that we become that leader who sees that talent in the young generation and give them the opportunity. If you ask me, I think that was my biggest learning from that moment, is that somebody needs to believe in you.
Okay. Meenu, thank you so much. You know, things that you said were very, very insightful. And I had been taking notes while you were talking, which I would like to present to our audience who is watching right now. So a few things that from all the stories that you have said till now, I have asked you six very specific stories after the initial story that you had told us. And I will just read them out. The very specific gist that I have for my audience from the story that Meenu had told us just now. Number one, smart work and determination. It's important. Instead of going ahead at a time when she had a fracture in her hand, if you remember, she learned and she understood that all she had to do was to learn to circle, and she used her left hand to make sure that she learned that. Smart work, end of the day, and determination might take you places. Secondly, find your support group when you are in trouble. More important than physical support, what you need is emotional support, because if your mind is convinced, your body can do the unthinkable. Third, make compromises that make you happy. She slept less because she wanted to spend time with her son, but that made her happy, and that compromise didn't remain a compromise any longer. Number four, don't ever take failure at face value, because failures make you fearless. Once you have gone through something, you know what it is to be, and you are less scared about facing that situation another time in your life. So just accept it. Yes, it is difficult. Accept it the way it is and move on. Team and the leaders matter a lot, because in your failure, those are the people who will support you and tell you this particular thing that Meenu has just told us, that be fearless about it. Don't get bogged down with your failure. Once it happens, you are fearless about one aspect in your life, and it's worth moving on with that learning. Sixth, in your list of achievements, don't forget yourself and your family. A most beautiful thing that Meenu had told us in her achievement, while naming her achievements, was that she considers buying that mixie for her mother her biggest achievement. Because I say it biggest, because that was the first achievement that came to her mind when I used the word achievement. That means that she is very, very closely rooted in her family, and their happiness matters to her. And when the family is together, your life is together, because everything else that happens outside remains outside. What happens inside you is all that you can create, carve, and leave a legacy on. Next, she told us, don't be scared of asking questions. One question had given her a raise. That is because she was compelled. She was convinced that that was a very compelling question which was worth asking. And she did that. And it paid her back the way it should. And last one, when you get certain things from your leaders, your team, your bosses, always make sure that you return the same to your juniors. There's very little that you can do to people who are more, bigger achievers than you are. You cannot return back their the goodness that they have bestowed in you, maybe. The only way to return it is to return the goodness to your juniors, people who are looking up at you for good work. Did I mention the points well, Meenu? Is there anything that you would like to add which can add value to the audience?
You know what, Coral? If I'm going to write a book on my life, I'm probably going to get your help to write it. I think you told my story better than me. I would just, sum up in one quote, which is almost like the motto of my life. I think I've shared with you earlier as well. You know, every time that I was bogged down and the devil whispers in my ears that you cannot fight the storm, I whisper back into devil's ears, I am the storm.
That's such a fabulous quote, and we will use it. Trust me, we will use it, and we will keep mentioning you in our gratitude notes. Thank you so much, Meenu, because I had a fabulous time talking to you, learning a lot, understanding a lot, and creating that particular graphical diagram that how life takes us towards something that probably we hadn't expected, but then life was convinced that we deserved and we should be given what we deserve.
Thank you so much, Coral. I think it was good karma that got us together. You're an amazing storyteller. Please keep on telling your stories. I would love hearing the stories and getting inspired. Yeah?
Thank you so much.